You are now listening to Music Marketing Metaphysics Podcast Radio Show, presented by AdeptInitiates.com, dedicated to the expansion of consciousness and the truth seekers of all time. And now your host, Anyextee.
Transmitting the teachings from Los Angeles, California, I'm your host, Anyextee, and this is Music Marketing Metaphysics Podcast Radio Show, presented by AdeptInitiates.com.
This episode is brought to you by AncientEgyptMysterySchools.com. Immerse yourself in the hidden teachings of the ancient mystery traditions. For thousands of years, initiates have examined the meanings of sacred texts said to hold the secret path towards ascension. But how can we decipher these often enigmatic phrases and symbols? Join the line of ascended masters on a quest for deeper truths of our universe. Follow along as we trace the powerful evolution of humankind's most illuminating secrets. Begin to embark on your journey today and discover your divine rite of passage at AncientEgyptMysterySchools.com.
And we are back with another edition of Music Marketing Metaphysics Podcast Radio Show. Now, I typically introduce guests in my own way, but to pay homage to today's special guest, I'm going to set things off differently by saying, greetings, everybody around the world, wherever you may be. You are very welcome to this edition of Music Marketing Metaphysics Podcast Radio Show. This is your host, Anyextee, and for the next hour, we'll be getting into some fascinating topics. But after this, you can check out live shows at CapricornRadio.com. They also have a new members area there. You can check out their full MP3 archive at CapricornMembers.com. They have a special lifetime membership fee for Capricorn members. This will entitle you to Capricorn radio shows and Capricorn TV interviews. To sign up for the members area, head over to CapricornMembers.com and equally follow links to CapricornRadio.com. Don't forget, you can also follow Capricorn Radio YouTube channel to Capricorn TV YouTube channel. And of course, the Capricorn Radio TV Facebook group and Facebook pages. Or you can also follow what today's guest does at James Swagger's Facebook group on Facebook too. And if you're not familiar with the routine I just did, you should be. That's because today's guest, we're going to be talking to Mr. James Swagger. And I'm delighted to be joined by this very special guest. Now, he's a bit of a humble guy, but we can't get started without giving him his proper intro. For he is a huge inspiration to this show, a broadcaster, host, and one whose show, by the way, I'm not ashamed to admit that I certainly benchmarked for this very show you're listening to now. So we'll first need some context, because you can't have a show called Music Marketing Metaphysics without doing some well marketing. And I've been a fan of his show going on a couple of years now, and I value it as one of the top platforms when it comes to exploring historical mysteries. As a researcher and enthusiast myself, someone who's obsessed with exploring the ancient mysteries, I'm a fan of other researchers. I think it's super critical to study everybody's work so that you're not just echoing what's already been said, but instead focusing on your efforts toward pushing the envelope and trying to really progress, you know, upon what's already been established. So if you've been following my work, you know that I have a deep passion for exploring our human history story. So when I want to go to the cutting edge and hear the latest updates from the best authors, researchers, and experts, I tune in to Capricorn Radio. Bottom line, if you want to be in the know, on the cutting edge, you go to Capricorn Radio. The wealth of service that this man has provided us with cannot go unnoticed. Our guest today is clearly one of the hardest working guys in the field. In a short time, he's managed to provide us with so much value from so many of today's brightest minds, creating not only a platform for these speakers, but also a very powerful resource for enthusiasts, fans, and up-and-coming researchers to study from. Now, beyond being the driving force over at Capricorn Radio, he's also a very fascinating researcher himself, a world traveler and an author. And he is here today to share from his experience in the field. He holds a master's degree in engineering, a bachelor's degree in physics with astronomy, and a master's degree in science, research, and society. With his science and engineering background, he embraces a multidisciplinary approach to the research of megalithic sites, particularly that of Ireland, but not limited to by any means. And he is the author of a number of books, including The Newgrange Sirius Mystery, which presents new evidence that suggests one of the most complex megalithic sites in the world was aligned also to Sirius, linking Passage Grave Cosmology with Dogon symbology. So with no further ado, today's special guest is Mr. James Swagger. James, welcome to the show.
Hey, Anyextee, thank you so much. I'm honored to hear all that. And I like when people do that, you know. They pay homage to what I've done in the past. And I am a humble guy. To be honest with you, I don't care about it too much, but it's nice to hear it, and I respect that. It's bizarre because I started Capricorn Radio after I started my authorship. And, you know, I found rock art in Ireland 2007. It wasn't in the record for what it was. It was constellations and alignments and stuff. And I started on this megalithic academic, because I'd always been into megaliths, but I did it in an academic sense. There was a whole host of reasons why I was there. It's a long story. I won't go into it.
Well, why don't you tell us a little bit about your background and how you were introduced to this subject matter, and how really you became acquainted with researching ancient knowledge and lost science?
Sure. Well, I had been briefly doing a magazine, a historical mysteries magazine. I loved it. I did it for a short period of time. I did it as a favor because I had engineering and science, and I was looking at the history of metallurgy and the history of, you know, these ancient maps and stuff like that. And I've always been keeping an eye on civilizations and mysteries, but I never did it in an academic sense until about 2007. But before all of that, I worked in the British Isles. And I mean, I've been to every city in the UK, I've been to every island off the coast of Britain, and I've been to every county in Ireland three times over for work, just normal, general work. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've traveled for about 14 years in the British Isles working as a systems analyst engineer. The only difference what I do now is I'm taking my systems analyst approach and I'm putting it to the megalithic mysteries, if you will. So I don't see myself doing anything different. I'm still taking my logistics brain, my systems analyst brain, and putting it to a puzzle that I feel worthwhile and I feel passionate about. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's all beautiful for me. But at the end of the day, I when I wrote that Newgrange Sirius mystery, I did it, first of all, I was in a race to do it for publishing, for copywriting. And, you know, had I looked back, I would have things probably done different. But, you know, you do as things as you go, and you grow and you evolve. But I got subjected into this, are injected into this megalithic mystery world. And I've always been checking them out. I was very privileged as a, it's kind of all linked anyway. As a systems analyst, I traveled all these different places as a, working in water industry, power generation, all of these remote areas in the UK and Ireland, from the Outer Hebrides right down to Cornwall. And all those regions are all megalithic regions. So I knew that, and I was like, okay, well, I'm going to capitalize on my location here. I'm going to go check out these places, because they're really, some of them, like the Outer Hebrides, is expensive and hard to get to unless you're an islander. So I capitalized on my location, and I did the research there. And I look back now, and it's like my life was planned out for this, like in some grand scheme. So I feel I had an arsenal of information there already on my fingertips. When I say academically doing it in 2007, I had no choice but to, because I found stuff not in the record. Soon after that, it was actually Michael Cremo was on the show. And Michael Cremo had a chat with me off air for about an hour afterwards. And he was genuinely interested in what I do. He says, James, why do you do this? Why are you podcasting? I said, well, actually, I'm an author as well. I mean, into all sorts of. He goes, I like megaliths. I keep an eye on it. You know, I'm into my deep antiquity of man and rise and fall of civilization and Kali Yugas and all that. But he says, you know, I like to keep an eye on everything. So he said, you know, James, you need to start going to conferences. You need to start meeting people. You need to start philosophizing with people. And you know, it's not just a radio show. You know, because he liked what I did and he liked the in-depth. He was one of my earlier shows as well.
So Cremo would be considered really an inspiration to 100%. Capricorn Radio?
100% NEXT, 100%. And John Anthony West as well. I know you had John on. John, for me, you know, he did this 20 years before Graham Hancock and Bovall came on the scene. And when that genre happened in about the early 90s, I was reading those books. And I think nobody could have realized at the time that not only did they create the genre, but they created an army of followers that then later became the authors 20 years later.
That's right.
I'd never have thought about that either.
Great, but great granddaddy of them all.
Yeah, 100%. And I'm going to meet him next May in the Megalithic Odyssey conference. I'm flying him in from New York. I have so much respect for John. I think, you know, he's 85 and he's still going strong. So, you know, and these are all people I read. So this isn't like I just woke up when I wanted to get into megaliths. I was always into historical mysteries. However, I think the Capricorn radio stuff kind of gave me something, and it's all linked, because when I did that, I found myself meeting other researchers quicker, easier. The information would come to me quick and fast. I liked doing it as well. I get to explore stuff on Capricorn Radio and podcast, and a lot of respect for you too, brother, because podcasting kind of gives you a different outlook on the world. You get to meet the most interesting people. I've turned it into a TV network now. I just had Anthony Peake with me here for 2 days in Geneva. We're doing a 4K video interview and stuff for the channel, and it's like everything I've done, you know, it's just exploded on Capricorn TV, and it eclipsed what I did as an author and researcher. But it also gave me the tools and the information and the people and the resources to then go back into the megalith the way I wanted to do it at the start, because Anyextee, that I went 100 miles an hour at everything. First year of Capricorn, I did 100 shows. The second year, I did 200 shows. And I just didn't want to wait for a decade for an archive. I just said, right, let's get the archive out of the way. It's like, I do everything at 100 miles an hour, though.
Tremendous amount of respect. Clearly, you've been relentless with the work with Capricorn Radio. You know, go ahead.
Just to add to that, just before you come in, just to add to that, then I'm doing the same. I'm going back to my roots now with megaliths now, because I'm doing the same with that. I'm doing season one Megalithic Odyssey. I know half the people because I've met them through Capricorn Radio TV, and I know, you know, Richard Cassaro as well. He's just been with me here as well. He's got some great content, and I'm trying to get some other people's research and bring it in and see where it gels and see where it doesn't. And so I'm doing season one Megalithic Odyssey. I'm doing 8 books co-authored with Maria Wheatley for Megalithic Odyssey, and then we're going to go straight to a season 2, which I'm shooting in 4K as well. So it's like I've been brought to this environment, and you not only are you in the environment, but you have the ability now to create more environment, if that makes sense. And that's what podcast has brought to me. The podcast and helped me along with being an author, meeting people, knowing people, networking. That then spilled into the TV stuff. I just always wanted to grow, and I've been growing ever since. And now it's coming back to a documentary for me. And it's like, if I had sat down, brother, to just write and invent all of this, I couldn't have done it better than it happened, you know, naturally. So
I don't know how you find the time to sleep with everything you're doing.
I don't sleep much.
Now, in addition to the podcasting, you're also a fascinating author and researcher in and of itself. So you've done a bit of research into Celtic lore and the ancient texts that support that. What happened in the 1940s that changed what was once considered the true history of Ireland? And perhaps you could tell us a bit about that history, James.
Sure. Well, the Irish mythology is I remember going back to Hancock and Beauvall coming on the scene. I liked all that historical mysteries, right? And I used to look at mythology in a very, very sinister way. I was like, oh, that's not what I need. This, I want historical. I'm very non-fiction guy, like, you know. And I'm like, that's all fiction. I want non-fiction. And I was very robotic in what I did. I was younger anyway. I was in my early 20s. And now I look at mythology as a rich resource. And I've come around to that way of thinking for many reasons. And I it came through Ireland. I mean, the subject of Lord of the Rings, that subject matter is the Irish mythology. That's well known. That pretty much everything you find in Lord of the Rings is in the Irish mythology. If you were to sit down and invent a science fiction story, you know, the best thing you could give, it's already there. It's called Irish mythology. So what you call mythology and what you call history, the Irish mythology was considered the true history of Ireland until relatively recent. And when you look at those 100-year-old translations of the Irish mythology, and we should call it really Celtic mythology, because there is a variance. So when I say Irish, it has got its own kind of theme. It's more corroborative. So you basically have all these different ancient books, these 7th century, 9th century, 12th century books and fragments of texts, and they all corroborate each other from different parts of Ireland and different epochs. So the oral histories were written down by the Irish monks who were trying to Christianize the quote pagan people. Whether those pagan people were what we think of as pagans today, I think they may have been more primitive, or, well, we shouldn't say primitive, the pagans today are what we call neo-pagans. So they were a bit more hardcore pagan, if you will. So neo-pagan is kind of morphed. Even the whole festival of Halloween coming up now in 3 days, right. It's got its roots in Ireland. The Irish origins of Halloween is a show I've done pretty much every year at this time. But it's basically a Samhain thing. It's called Samhain in Irish, and it's got its deep roots in paganism. And the Christianity was very successful in taking that custom off the Irish. It's still the month of November in Irish is called Iha Samhain, the night in November, because it was originally the 3rd of November. And the 3rd of November got shifted to what we call October 31st because of All Saints Day, All Souls Day, and then Hallows Eve, Halloween. It's a whole podcast in itself. There's a reason why it happened, but they wanted that custom off those because they wanted to convert people. It wasn't even that successful. Everything they tried to do, the monks, the Christianity tried to do in Ireland. Ireland was its own resistance movement to Christianity, and everything they did to try and convert the paganism almost failed. I can nearly argue that Christianity was converted to paganism. It adopted so many customs and it bent so many rules to get the Irish to convert that they ended up adopting so many of the pagan customs and beliefs. In that respect, then they needed dialogue to do that. So dialogue was a major thing, and how they got that dialogue was to write down the oral histories of Ireland, because that's what got them talking. That's the only thing they wanted to talk about. It was their oral histories. And all of these stories of our ancient Ireland, the famous Book of Leinster, the Book of the Taking of Ireland, the Book of Invasions, the Book of Annals of the Ulster, Annals of the Four Masters. There's hundreds, the Book of Duncow. There's lots and lots of different versions of these books. But a lot of the stories have the same figures in them. There's 74 deities or gods and goddesses in the Irish pantheon of gods. They were known as the Two of the Danann, what we call the, quote, fairy folk that is in The Lord of the Rings. That's pretty much the same transition there. There's not much evolved in that. I think he added on pointy ears or something like that in the movie. But apparently all the things that you see, they were known as the Shining Ones. They all had a beautiful glow about them. They either looked ugly or beautiful. And they were all little people as well. And then you had the Fomorian giants. And, you know, so then we had normal people, what we would call Fir Bog, the men of bags, the Numidians, the sons of Nemed, sons and daughters of Nemed. And so we had five groups that were in Ireland. And these were the people before the Irish Celts. And that's basically, the Irish Celts were basically the last group, the Milesian Gaels, which we think were coming from Spain, the sons of Mil or Mils Hispania. So what we then find is the last group is the ones that are left on the island, the ones that have finally conquered everything, because the Two of the Danann, these fairy folk, were retracted into the hills and they just went underground. Underground figuratively and underground physically. Regardless of whatever you think of all of that, the monks wanted to dialogue with these people, so they wrote down all these oral histories. And had they have fully understood this, Anyextee, had they fully have understood any of this, they wouldn't have wrote any of it down because it was in direct, you know, opposition to the church's belief system. So right. What we find is they were even writing footnotes in the margins of the books going, we don't understand what this term means, it's an archaic term, but they still were meticulous enough to write it down. So we know that they didn't fully understand everything. However, we have evidence that they did convert some of these pagans, but then the pagans themselves operated within the church to survive. Work of Thomas Sheridan, great guy. He's a co-presenter in the documentary. I have Thomas there because he's a great researcher. He's researching the Vikings, psychopaths, mythology, megaliths. He's into all sorts, and he's a very passionate guy. But I love what Thomas, his mindset on the pagan conversion to Christianity. And there's people that he can say, well, I think that guy was a pagan and he got converted, but he wanted to operate within the church. Everything was like the rituals that was associated with these, quote, monks and priests, there you can tell, well, that was a pagan who converted. So it was a very difficult problem. And it was a 300-year process that really kind of ended and failed. So that whole Irish mythology was preserved for a reason, and it was because of that difficult period. bizarrely, that Christianity preserved our history for us. And still today, I mean, you go to the island of Ireland, I mean, apart from two cities of Dublin and Belfast on the east coast, the rest of the island is empty. 2 million people live in a tiny little county in Dublin. Another 500,000 live in Belfast, and all the rest of the island is like 2.5 million scattered in, over small towns. So still today, the monuments are still there, decaying in a field. The landscape looks no different probably to what it did 5,000 years ago. It's rural and it's agricultural land. And the mythologies are still there. The names of the places, the mountains, Knock na Shi. Knock means hill. Shi is the nickname for the two of the Danann fairy folk. The Shi, well, Shi means mound, and Dinna Shi is people of the mounds. And the stories are all the same. The customs, Halloween was basically the custom of called Samhain and Samhain. And that basically survives today. The pumpkin wasn't really the thing. That was an American thing. When the Irish went to America, they didn't have any turnips or Swedes to carve. So they used pumpkins. The next best thing they had, which was the Halloween pumpkin idea. But the reason they wore masks and disguised themselves was because they didn't want the two of the Danann to recognize them. They thought they could take their souls away. They thought they could take them. And so if they didn't see their face or recognize them, they didn't know who to look for. So now we have some weird thing where we dress in costumes to scare people, where it was the whole thing has morphed so many times. It was it morphed from the people of the mounds. The Milesian Gaels fought these people. These were the last people. And then, so they were always trying to subdue them in battle. I know you're into Egypt as well. So some of the stuff is paralleled. I mean, when you read about Ishtar, she's mimicked with the Morrigan. She's got like hoven feet or like crow's feet. Goddess of sex and war, Ishtar, goddess of sex and war.
So with like
and
Ishtar, are you finding correlations to the Anunnaki or Sumerian text as well, James?
Two of the Danann is the tribe of the goddess of Anu, and people make that link. And you know what? I'm open to it. I could have also been the last tribe of Dan with Israel, and I understand that people want to make that link. It's a bit too reliant on etymology, but there is also stuff with like, sure. If you read about Abkon, the Irish deity, Abkon, he's very like Bez from Egypt, dwarf who played music and subdued his subjects in battle by hypnotizing them with music.
Interesting.
So it's very interesting. So I just leave it at that sometimes. I make the correlations, and the Irish mythology is so wild in places and then so very normal as well. So you talk about giants and then you talk about these weird deities with like, you know, crow's feet and dwarfs and stuff like that. But then you have normal people that are like the Milesian Gaels, and they're, then you talk about people breeding with each other, like the Fomorian giants were breeding with the two of the Danann, and they were half sisters and half brothers. And then you have stepfathers and, you know, normal squabbling, warmongery that goes on in all sorts of historical cultures. So there's some sort of a normal aspect to it too. It's not all fantasy land. You even have Nuada of the Silver Arm. This story of he guy had a prosthetic limb. He had his arm was chopped off in battle, and he had his silver prosthetic arm. Some of the stuff that you read is, you know, you couldn't make this stuff up in the time it was done. It seems so abstract.
What time period would that be, James? What would we be looking at in terms of, you know, the point in history?
Well, okay, that's a good question, because what we have is a story that's an oral history that's never really stopped. So the people of the mounds. The very fact that they're talking about the mound builders are the people of the mounds, and they're cairn material, stone mounds and earthen mounds are both. So the people of the mounds, well, we know from an archaeological standpoint that they hit Ireland in two waves. They hit them in 5000 BC and about 3500, 3000 BC. There seems to be a gap of 1500 years with nothing in between. So Carrow Moor Megalithic Cemetery is 5000 BC, carbon dated, and Carrow Keel, 20 miles away, is carbon dated 3500 BC, and I have a lock on that as well with Cassiopeia correlation theory. That's in the Newgrange Sirius mystery book, and that's a great correlation. It's 100% accurate to like it's very hard to deny that once you see it. So those are the mound builders' true kind of epoch. But the guys were in existence between 5000 and 1000 BC. They had a 4000 year building program. They seemed to peter out and fizzle out at the same time as the Celts are migrating in. So the Celts, the Irish Celts today, they came from the east. They came from the top of Italy. Well, they came past the top of Italy. We know that they battled with the Romans. The Gaelic Celts battled with the Romans at the top of Italy. They had come from the east a bit further. and marched along. Where they originated from, nobody's really sure, but they came and then they got to the Danube. They marched along the Danube all the way through Europe until they got to the top of France. And then when they crossed over to Britain and Ireland, those Celts separated from mainland Celts. So you had the Germanic Celts, or those originating in Germanic countries and France. And then you have the British and Irish Celts being their own kind of excluded pockets then. So at the earliest we give the Celts is 1500 BC, the very earliest, perhaps even less than that, you know, maybe 1000 BC. So where you see the two of the Dan and She, people of the mounds, die out, you also see the Celts appear. And bizarrely, that's what you read in the stories as well, that these guys were on their way out. They were the last of a lineage of five people who took Ireland. So the Book of the Taking of Ireland is a great source if anybody wants to read Irish mythology. And by the way, just to add to that, when you read the translations of the Irish mythology, there's a 1903 translation from the Gaelic, ancient Irish Gaelic to modern Gaelic, and then from modern Gaelic into English. It's no interpretation. They're not interpreting what they think it means. It's a direct translation. And it's like Dan Brown, Da Vinci Code, science fiction, whatever. You know, it's like that level of popularity. You know, it's like reading Lord of the Rings. So that's the level of translation that it was done back then. And then that tells you, well, if you're reading something that looks like a technical aspect to, I mean, they had like longevity as well. Just to throw another few things at you. So they talk about the Ogs as well. You call the Nephilim Og, or the Og, the King of Bashan. The name Og, it is prevalent all across Ireland and Britain as well. In England, all around Stonehenge, you have Ogburn, Og Mary St. Burn. In Ireland, you have List Og Hill. In Carrollmore Cemetery, the megalithic place, you have Ogma, the guy who invented the Irish language. He was known as Honey Milt or Ogma. There's Angus Mac Og, Angus son of Og. He was related to the Fomorians and the two of the Danann. So this name Og, there's Land of Og as well, Tirna and Og. They were always forever young. Anybody who went to Tirna Og had like time slips and weird things going on. So, you know, it's incredibly interesting and incredibly fascinating to read all this stuff. I looked through it for some sort of, you know, the reason I'm looking at this, by the way, is because of, I have to, I can't deny it.
Sure.
There's something weird about the Irish mythology that, you know, they talk about these people, whoever they were, the two of them, and they came from the Western Seas, that the people of the mounds, these two of the Dan and She people, they came from the Western Seas, from a mythical island that was surrounded with mist. I personally think that's High Brazil. I look at it. There's geological evidence for that. It's on ancient maps. I've been to the Globe Museum in Vienna. It's on the Mercator Globe. It's in the exact same location as Porcupine Bank, geological sandbank. And then we have the Irish mythology backing it up as well. There's three points of reference there. So I look at that and I say, in every mythology, there's a core body of truth. And maybe we just don't understand it from our modern perspective. And we just go, you know what? We don't believe that. And that's mythology, and wipe it.
And now Irish actually comes from Ogham scripts, correct?
Yeah, so the Ogham or so the G is silent, Om. So like the Greek letter Om. So we pronounce it Om, but then the English pronounce it Ogham because they don't understand the silent.
right.
So, but yeah, Om or Ogham script. It's basically like a runic writing as well. It's like a series of dashes, and it's not a full alphabet like we would have, like the English or Latin alphabet. Each letter was correspondent to a tree, so that you can have like an ash tree, a birch tree, and so on for A, B, C, D. And then those were able to put place names and people's names and titles. That was kind of what it was. So that was then converted into the Latin alphabet by the Irish monks, who, by the way, gave us the Irish language too. Because this Om script was then converted into a Latin alphabet. So that's where you get the modern Gaelic as a conversion of the Om script. These Om stones or Ogham stones, there's about 400 known examples all across Ireland. Some say there's some in America too, and some in Scotland and other little parts of Britain. But they're rare examples. But they may have parchments of bark, or they have carved the runic writing or this on sticks or stone, you know.
Right. I believe there's an example of that. I grew up on the East Coast in the States, in the mm. state of Massachusetts at Dighton.
Oh, wow.
Dighton Rock. And I believe it's... I believe it's...
Well, there's some serious stuff up there, too, yeah, brother. I mean, the chambers up there. I don't know if you know Jim Vieira,
yeah,
but...
Yeah, sure. Jim Vieira and Hugh Newman, well, more so Jim, but they have that book on the Giants on Records.
Giants.
Yeah, and yeah, they've done some fascinating work there.
But all those chambers up in East Coast, I personally think that these Og people... Well, here's the thing with the Og, right? So if you talk about Og in Ireland, you're talking about longevity and being forever young. If you talk about Og in the Middle East, you're talking about Nephilim, Og, the King of Bashan, and all of that. You're talking about these people of stature. But we have the people of stature in Ireland too, the Fomorians. Mm. So I find it bizarre that both this Og is all over the British Isles. I mean, Wigtown Shire, is, and if you look at the Ogs in there as well, you know, all these OG, this name, Gog Magog from Cornwall, it's everywhere. Og, all across the British Isles, it has Og. Og is in everything. There's no reason for it. There's the etymology of this is nobody really understands. But then we also have tales of people living for longevity too. Just like we have in the scriptures from the Qumran scriptures as well. So I don't know. I look at this and I say maybe people did live a bit longer, or they maybe were a bit more physical stature. So when you talk about the Nephilim Og Fomorians, if you want to give them a full title, call them what you will, I think those red-haired giants were in them in Ireland, and I think there was two races. I even go to Sardinia, and the people that carved the monuments in Sardinia, they had to be little people there. I mean, I went to rock cut chambers, acoustic chambers, and same megalithic artists, spirals and bulls, and the bull symbolism's all there. It's incredible. What you're looking at is a room that a 4 foot tall person could barely fit into. Anyextee. I'm 6 foot three, and I couldn't even get into some rooms. I would be cuddled over, my back would be hitting the ceiling. And then they have strange little carved faces on the outside of these rock cut chambers as you go in, and they just don't look like the normal skull types that we have. And they have an actual skull of a normal person beside this weird looking sheer skull chain. They even have small strange skulls in Santa Museum in Sardinia. And they call all of these rock cut tombs, you ready? The Domus de Janus, the House of the Fairies. Mm. And I think there was some sort of you look at skull types, and I think look at the stuff in Peru. I think we had look at the skull types from Paracas, okay? Mm. Look at the hypogeum skulls. They have were elongated, they had no sagittal suture in the hypogeum as well. Where is the new hybrid, or we'll call them hybrids, or call them a mysterious human strain that we don't know yet? We call Denosovan man. We found a finger bone and he gets a name, Denosovan man, or hominin X. Right. We find Homo floriensis in Indonesia. He gets his own human strain, a branch of the human tree. Where's these other guys, these skulls? Oh no, they're deformed. But they're all symmetrical. You know, so there's something bizarre going on, that you have megalithic sites or ancient cultures that have a rich wealth of another human strain, I think, that was either on the planet. And I think that we probably had small people and we had giants, and they were all either adopted into the gene pool like Neanderthals, or else exterminated to some level. So I personally think that the stuff in America, you know, that you see appear, those red-haired giants over there, I think there's a lot in the record that says that they were there. And I think that the mound builders of America came from originally from Ireland, because where you see them disappear in Ireland, you see them appear in America. And I think they were persecuted and they went there. And that's not just fanciful either. We know that the copper from Northern America has such a signature, something like 99.7% purity, that the Bronze Age of Europe had to be fueled from that same copper ore, because there is no other match for copper ore on the planet. It had to have come from there. So somebody had to mine tons and tons and tons of copper, shipping it by boat and migrating it into Europe for the feed the Bronze Age.
Now, James, if we take, let's say, Eastern thought into consideration, in the work of like a Self-Realization Fellowship, Sri Yukteswar and Paramahansa Yogananda, this period that you talked about before was like the descending time in the Yuga cycle. It was a time of clairvoyance. Do you think these people had some sort of connection in terms of telepathy, like the abilities of these people? How does
it's amazing you asked me that question, Anyextee. I just said goodbye to Anthony Peake today. Anthony Peake, I don't know if you know Anthony. He's kind of
a great book. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he just came out and he's got such evidence to explain that. I personally think they do, and I'm not that freaked out by the idea of telepathy. I think we just got electromagnetic fields coming out of our brain, and people know how to decode them and receive them, like we do with transmitters and receivers. I'm from an electronics background. I did electronics engineering when I was a kid. I used to build ham radio and everything.
Brilliant.
I think of the world in electromagnetic frequencies. That's my science engineering background. I'm not freaked out by that idea. People have epiphanies, and they understand people, and they just tune into people, literally tune into them. And we have an electromagnetic field around the brain, we have an electromagnetic field around the heart. And, you know, why not? Why wasn't there a time when people could do that? I think consciousness is directly linked with that, and that's a lot of Anthony Peake's work. Anthony's got some really good science articles to back that up to mainstream academia. And I'll refer people to the work of him. So I think, yes, there was that time. Where I personally look at that, and I know we've pioneered... you know, a lot of research in the last 40 years with all these different authors out there. And I think, you know, not only has a little revolution happened, but there's been serious academic research done in the alternative genre. It's not been soaked into mainstream yet, but it will eventually.
Absolutely, yeah.
But I think it's a rise and fall of civilization. I think the Kali Yuga is 100%. I think it's direct. Personally, I think it's directly related to the processional cycle. I think the processional cycle with 12 zodiacal 2160 years in a processional zodiacal house times 12, that's a sexadecimal number. The ancient Sumerians and the Egyptians were obsessed with a sexadecimal system, and they used a sexadecimal system, base 60 degrees, 60 seconds, 60 minutes, 12 inches, a foot. That all goes back to the Sumerians. That's been proven. Alan Butler has done a great work on that called Civilization One. You can't deny that once you see it. And if you look at this sexadecimal system, there is no better number system to explain the processional cycle, because it's 12 times 2160. 2160 is equal to 6 by 6 by 6 by 0. Or you can say that there's 25,920 years in a zodiacal house, and that's equally divisible by 60. So the thing is, if you have to use a base 20 system or base 10 system, base 10 system like we use, decimal, is very clumsy. Base 60 system is perfect. It's more complicated in everyday math. Like, if we do normal everyday maths, you want to go and buy sweets in your shop, you know, great, decimal system's fine for that. 10 cents, 20 cents, 30 cents, all up to 100 cents in a dollar. Fine. But, I mean, if you want to do a sexadecimal system in a sexadecimal unit solar system, where for interprocessional cycle, that's why I think these ancient cultures were using that. And I think they had deep knowledge of the processional cycle. And you look at the Temple of Dendera, and that zodiac's there. It's the oldest representation in art. I think the oldest representation of the night sky is the Nebra sky disk, which is equally fascinating. But the oldest representation of the night sky in art is the Dendera zodiac. And it's sitting there in all its glory. It's incredibly advanced. I mean, here's the thing, when they fixated that zodiac, here's the really bizarre thing, when they fixated that zodiac on the four axes, like the Taurus-Scorpio axis, I mean, there's four stars there, Regulus, Antares, and the way they fixed that zodiac, I mean, those stars don't deviate over long, long epochs. I mean, long epochs, longer than the processional cycles. So they're like the four fixed stars or the four fixed axes of that Dendera zodiac. How they knew that? That's what I find stupefying, because we need to look through gas clouds to know this information. We need to look with high-powered telescopes to look through all that. Is there, you know, you look at what Anthony Peake, I think these guys tapped into a universal consciousness. And I think that with rise and falls of civilization, I think we're incredibly handicapped right here, right now. And I think, when you look at the philosophy of the ancients, these guys, not just, you can talk about Fibonacci, and I appreciate all that, you know, but it's not just the Fibonacci thing, and I think it's everything. These guys were polymaths, and I'm talking polymaths in the purest sense. They looked at nature and harmony with the phi, the golden ratio, because they seen that mirroring your own philosophy on the nature of the universe. You're not fighting it, trying to figure it out against the odds where, you know, decimal systems and scientific calculators and machines. You're looking at the nature. You're synthesizing yourself with the natural harmony of the universe. And I think that's, when they had done that, I think the both hemispheres of the brain, they were firing all their synapses, you know. And I think that's why they achieved the great Mason's work, the great pyramid, the, you know, like Richard Cassara would say, the master Masons of the past. I think, and he agrees that, you know, these guys had a super philosophy, first and foremost. Let's not write this all off with weird and wonderful, you know, you can talk about ancient technology and high times all you want, but give it to the humans that we know they had abilities. I just think they had a different brain and a different consciousness to us.
Sure.
And I think we're stuck in a left brain world now. I always go on about this. I mean, I came through like a left brain environment. I watched an incredibly indoctrinated system, you know, going through a highly industrial processes and watching a mostly male dominated environment. I've been in a left brain environment most of my career. And, you know, I'm very balanced. I've done left brain, right brain tests. I know exactly what I'm talking about. Everybody sees me. All they see is that guy because they see the science guy, they see the engineering. But I'm incredibly creative and expressionistic on the other side. They just don't see it because that's the environment that I had to be in. And I just think that's what we try to reward. There's a reward system for the left brain world. There's no reward system for art and creativity and music. It's that's the true genius to me. However, they're not mutually the opposite of each other, Anyextee. If you look at a left brain world, we measure that with the IQ test. We measure that with intelligence. That was created by the American military. If you look at the right brain world, how do you measure art? How do you measure music in an IQ test? You can't do that. But they're not mutually the opposites of each other, and here's why. If you look at a left brain world, okay, you know, it's very practical. If you want to know memory, rote memory and all of that, that's great. If you want to do tasks and you want to do physical tasks and, you know, excel in day-to-day goings on, that's fine. But a right brain, you still need to do those things. You still need to do that in a right brain world. So if you're a right brain world, you have like the left brain tasks incorporated into the right brain. Well, you still need to brush your teeth. You need to know when to eat. You need to know when to sleep when you're tired. You're doing very logical left brain tasks in a right brain world. However, in a left brain world, you can be stuck in there and have no right brain accommodated at all. You could sanitize the left brain world with having no art, no music, no creativity if you want. It's no necessity to be there. They're not mutually the opposites of each other.
James, let's talk about Master Masonry again for a minute here. Your first book was about Newgrange, the Newgrange Sirius mystery, linking Passage Grave Cosmology with Dogon symbology. Could you tell us a bit about Newgrange a little more and explain what Passive Grave is?
I'll make the distinction between Newgrange is the most complex megalithic site in the world. That's because there's Newgrange Passage Tomb. It's quartz facade with a passageway going into an incredibly ornate, sophisticated astronomical observatory, but there's a great circle around that as well. 2 miles from that, there's the Great Mound of Noth, the biggest in passageways in Europe, and it's got 18 satellite mounds around the big one. And then you have another mound called Doth, and then you have Henges, and then within that whole Boyne Valley, there's like 40 megalithic chambers, all with alignments and stars and everything. And it's just like a giant open air observatory. And that's why it's the most complex megalithic site in the world, because there's so much incredible stuff going on. Just within Newgrange itself, you know, look at, it's not, it's more conceptual. The technology in there is more creative and conceptual. Like if you look at the Sacsayhuaman wall in Peru, beautiful. It's the biggest jigsaw in the world. It's incredible. It's a major, major feat of engineering and architecture, second to none, really. I mean, yeah, the size of the Great Pyramid. I'm talking about size. I'm just talking about a complex polygonal wall like the Sacsayhuaman thing. I just don't even know how they achieved it. It's as an engineer, if you gave me all the limited resources and time and people, I couldn't even do that with what we give the tools of the day. Set that aside, you know, that's megalithic intensity. Well, what you see is the same type of stuff in Newgrange, Noth, Stonehenge, Callanisha, and the Outer Hebrides. But it's more conceptual. They had it in, you know, so all of these megalithic cultures, they're all highly advanced. They're all philosophical polymaths who built them. You know, they just did it, their technology, in different ways. So we can look at Newgrange and go, oh, stone, earth, and mud, and it's just a chamber. And you walk in and you go, okay, a sunbeam comes in. That's all people look at these days. and that's weird. They look at the spectacle of the sun coming in and go, oh, illuminates, and we can sit there for 15 minutes. That was nothing to these people. That was, yes, there was a ritual aspect associated with that on the special day, but figuring out the solstices and equinoxes is a very simple thing. It's what they used that. They used that to then figure out moon cycles, and then they figured out Venus as well, and then they figured out precession. So here's what they did. They bring the sunbeam in on the shortest day of the year, whether that's on an equinox or a solstice. Different monuments are aligned to solstices and equinoxes. They bring the sunbeam in. They get that sunbeam to penetrate about 60 feet into Newgrange, which is incredible because they have to build it from the inside out. They have to make sure the sunbeam is going to end up at the back chamber, precisely on the back wall, then build the chamber knowing where the sunbeam finishes, and then make sure that that sunbeam will go down a very long chamber. And then what they do is they also make the chamber meandering like this. So they meander the chamber so that it blocks the sunlight from the doorway, but they put a special box in so that the sunbeam comes above your head. And why you don't block the sunbeam is because the passageway is also ascending as well as meandering, so that you arrive where the sunlight is. Where the sunbeam is where they started first, where the sunbeam finished. And then they build a passageway and the chamber, and then they backfill it in with a curbstone, and then the car material is just like a heap of stone. It may have actually looked like a truncated stone of quartz top. They put it up as a wall because it slipped on one side. So a 1960 recreation on the facade, set that aside. The rest is all original inside.
Where were the stones quarried from, James?
Several different places. You have the quartz quarried from 40 miles away in the Wicklow Mountains. I've been to the source of where the quartz is. There's another passage to him there called Seafin Hill. I'll come back to that in a moment. So then you have the grey cobblestones. They came from 20 miles to the north of Northern Ireland. And then you had the grey wacky curbstones, the big giant curbstones around the perimeter. They came from 20 miles to the west. So that's where the nearest quarries are. But they mined quartz and shipped it all around as a commodity, large quantities too. I mean, the Boyne Valley is riddled with quartz, and the nearest quartz is the Wicklow Hills. But that Seafin Hill passage tomb, they used the quartz vein that runs through the rock. They worked the rock away in one zone, exposing that sheet of quartz vein, and then used it as a feature upright standing stone as to line the passageway, so that when sunbeams or starlight came in, it illuminated the passageway with quartz reflected walls. These things are very sophisticated, but you need to train your eye to see what the sophistication is. You don't just walk in and say, okay, sunbeam comes in here, illuminates the chamber, and this is a great spectacle. They had these days for observation. Here's the thing, and you'll appreciate this from the work of John Anthony West and heliacal risings. So you have, this is related, and I'll try and sum this up with Newgrange and Doe. So Newgrange has the heliacal rising of Sirius, and then you also have at Doe the heliacal rising of Pleiades, and it's encased in stone. They face their own image in the sky when these things were built. Precession of the equinox then knocks these guys out. And then 300 years later, we know that these passage tombs were then decommissioned. For example, when a star rises on the horizon on, say, the spring equinox, okay, you have to wait a full precessional cycle before that's in exactly the same position. It may look like it's in the same position next year, but it's actually off a fraction. And then it's off a fraction the next year. And then it's off a fraction the next year. You wait 72 years, it's off exactly 1 degree. So you divide a degree into 70 by 72. That's the accuracy that you're off by every year. But that's not noticeable to the human eye. I mean, what's appreciable? So think in a layman's language. So you're looking at 3 degrees is the width of the moon on the horizon. So that would be equal to 216 years of precession. So 216 years later, a star will be off the width of the full moon. That would give you a layman's way of understanding it. So you don't need to align constellations and watch a whole precessional cycle before you know. You don't need to calculate 25,920 years. You need to just wait 216 years and you'll see it off. And that's a weird one as well, because 216 is that precessional number again. It's also the 2160 miles is also the width of the moon in miles. And I think that's all that sexadecimal system again. Wow. So a precessional cycle kicks something off. Well, what do we know they did? Well, they put rows, standing rows. They put a standing stone as a marker stone or a menhir. They had rows of standing stones, and they aligned them to stars and constellations. And they come back 72 years, it's off a degree. 72 years, it's off another degree. So after Wizard of Full Moon, it's incredibly appreciably noticeable. Well, they were also building these things over long epochs. Stonehenge over a 1,000-year building program. In Loch Crew megalithics to the west of the Newgrange, you're talking at least a 1,000-year building, maybe 800 to a 1,000-year building program there. Passage tombs popping up every 50, 100 years. So these things were decommissioned. They put in like a slot, bucked off the doorway, backfilled it in, and decommissioned these things out there. Gabrini and Brittany and France had the same thing, decommissioned. So I personally think that precession is the thing to look at. And of course, we know precession's there. We know that it must have affected these people. And then when I look in the record and I look at all this stuff, I find that I think these people knew about it too. They had to have. They had that standing rose. They had to have noticed this, at least over several generations. Looking back at Newgrange, the people who built Newgrange started putting the first pegs in the ground, the first architects, the first surveyors. It was their great-grandchildren probably seen it finished. If you give them a life expectancy of about 30 years, it was probably about 52 years just to survey the place, just to make sure that that sunbeam penetrated 60 feet. You'd have to come back every solstice and mark it. And how you mark it the solstice is easy in concept, but it's very time-consuming, and you're at the mercy of the Irish weather as well. So you basically see the sunrise in the east, sets in the west. Well, in the northern latitudes, what you have is the sun rises in the northeast and sets in the northwest on summer solstice. Winter solstice, it rises in the southeast and sets in the southwest. And then it rises in the east and sets in the west. So you can mark those points out in the horizon, and you'll get like an angle, a triangle. And that angle of that triangle is equal to your latitude too. It's directly related to your latitude. So all they had to do was measure the extreme points of the solstices and the equinoxes. Equinox is in the middle, by the way. Spring and autumn equinox in the middle. So it's not rocket science. You just need to observe where the sun is every day, put a peg in, and then you'll see it moving along the horizon, backwards and forwards, and in the middle, and backwards and forwards, and in the middle. But that takes a long time. That's probably 50 years. Then you have to build a monument. And then if you incorporate any other, like metonic cycles or lunar stuff, which is prevalent at Noth, just around the corner, I mean, that's an 18.6-year cycle that they have encoded in stone as well. Mm. You're talking extremely long epochs. And then if you take an average life expectancy, which the archaeology is saying 25 to 30 max, you're talking like several generations there to see this monument finished with the last bit of stone put in place.
Brilliant. So what exactly is a passage grave?
I hate the name, but I use it. I hate it. It's a tomb that's got a passageway in it. And it doesn't explain anything about the true function of the monument.
And so is there any actual like forensic evidence to suggest these locations were indeed graves?
Yes, but there's also forensic evidence to say that cathedrals, the Gothic cathedrals of Europe are graves too. But do we call them graves?
Right.
No. We call them places of worship, or we call them works of architecture. We call them, you know, master masonry or works of art, if you want to call them. But we don't call them, you know, tombs, do we? But the same thing applies to the Neolithic monuments of Europe. So we call them Neolithic because of the age they were built in, and we call them megalithic because of the architecture they were put in. And then we give them names like tumulus, and we give them names like passage tombs, and we call them cairns, and we call them chambered mounds, and we call them everything. But what they are is like masterpieces of architecture. So basically, they nicknamed them passage tombs because there was bodies found in Newgrange, and just because there's ceremonial remains, there was a ritual sense. That's not, I don't want to deny that either. It's not something I concentrate on. If there is a ritual aspect found there, they had ceremonial urns or bowls where they would put the cremated remains. I personally think the astronomer, priests, shamans, whoever was in there, I think they were buried there. The people that, you know, worked those monuments or observed there, I think they were given the rite of passage to be buried there. Mm-hmm. And it's just the way we put saints and knights into cathedrals. It's the same function, a great analogy. But they have a passageway, and it's usually opened up to a solstice or an equinox or a moon alignment or a star or constellation. So each monument has the same kind of look about it. It's a mound, usually curved stones, but sometimes the backfill is soil on top of stone, or sometimes it's just pure stone. So we call that a cairn is basically a heap of stone in Gaelic. So when we call them cairns, we call them heaps of stone. It's not a very illustrious name, but so chambered cairns or chambered mounds. And there's no sense of unity just in the linguistic analogy or labels that we put on these. So, but make no mistake, a passage tomb is incredibly advanced. It's basically like a big long optical tube pointing on the horizon. So when you have done that, you've put a very long, putting a short tube doesn't make it accurate. It's when you put a 60-foot long optical tube on the horizon, you've got pinpoint accuracy. You know, to make something penetrate that chamber like a sunbeam go down 60 feet is incredibly accurate. Here's the thing about, and this is the Sirius thing. Let's bring that in for a minute.
Right, Sirius, I'm interested to learn about how.
It's quite simple. You look on the horizon, you're looking out the front, looking down the passageway on the horizon. Every 21st of December, sunbeam comes down, illuminates the chamber at 8:58 a.m. for 17 minutes. Come back next 21st of December. It's the same thing every year. It happens a day either side, but the accurate day is the solstice. So these guys had a master feat of engineering for that. Well, the thing is, in 3200 BC, Sirius was on the horizon in exact same location, pretty much doing the same thing the sun did, only 12 hours later. Now, if you're telling me these guys didn't notice that when they were in the business of astronomy and cosmology and mapping the skies, well, then, you know, I don't know how everybody's missed this. Now, here's the thing. I'd actually had watched John Anthony West's Magical Egypt, which I'm sure you're aware of, Anyextee, and I remember looking at how the Temple of Dendera was illuminated by Sirius, illuminated the passageway temple. And I just got it, and I went, that's Newgrange. And I looked at it, and I looked at things in a very... I knew about a possible Sirius alignment from the Ulster Journal of Archaeology in 1983. Mm. And I went... that's the art. The art is going to back that up. And I looked for it in the art. So I said to myself, okay, at some time before precession, because the precession is going to knock all the stars out. And this happens, the same thing for the Pleiades, by the way, at Dose. There's another curbstone with a map of the Pleiades on it at Dose. And it's the same type of thing. So a heliacal rising of that star, you come back, you know, 25,000 years, that's it. But it has to have migrated into the position of the same as the chamber. So 24th of December, I think 200 years before Newgrange was built, they must have known it was going to be in the same position as the sun. If they knew it was processing or moving, they would have said, well, it's going to be in the same position as the sun. Here's the thing. It rises on the horizon and it goes upwards. And the next year, it's a bit more to the left and it rises and goes upwards. And the next year, processes a bit more to the left. It doesn't matter at what rate it does this, but it's going upwards. Because don't forget, it's like the sun. It's the sun's rising over the horizon and going upwards. And so the star is doing the same thing. That's covering, over a few hundred year window, that's covering the whole region of the sky because it's rising, going upwards, plus also moving to the left over long periods of time. At some point in time, around time the Newgrange was built, that Sirius entered that chamber because it covered the whole region of the sky. It's just a matter of what time. When you look at the astronomy program, the calculations, you will see that Sirius is on the horizon on the 24th of December, in the same epoch, at the same time, in almost the same position. And then the thing is, it precesses into exactly the same position as the sun, 100%. And then it will, again, another 72 years later, it will precess out of the way. And then after a couple of hundred years, the whole event is gone. And I think they personally marked the precession of Sirius with that triple spiral on the entrance stone. It's bizarre that you can... I measured this. It's 0.454 meter. I took a measuring tape out. I jumped over. I measured the stone. It's 0.45 meter from the center of the solstice line to the center of the triple spiral. And I think the triple spiral was to mark a degree of precession. They were calculating this down. They said, okay, let's signify a degree of precession. And the triple spiral for me marks the Sirius star. Then you come and you come back 72 years later. It migrates into the chamber and illuminates it on the same day. They mark the event. Oh. And where do you find the triple spiral? Only two examples of it, inside as well. And nobody has ever thought to explain why the triple spiral is inside and outside. It doesn't occur anywhere else in the Megalithic Empire. And it's not even a triple spiral. It's a double spiral. Represents the equinox. And it's got a spiral just attached to the left of it. If you look at the tri-spiral on the entrance stone, you will see that it's a triple spiral. Well, if you look closer at the triple spiral, you'll see it's a double spiral, a conjoined spiral, like an S, the way you would draw an S, you know, would keep that S going into a spiral. It's like that with a little spiral attached to the left of it. And we know that, I personally think that's Sirius processing with the equinox. I think that's literally what it means. And there's a lot, and it's not just a fancy concept. There's a lot of evidence done to explain why the double spiral a reverse double spiral is going back to the actual physical equinox. And then you see the triple spiral appear at the same point in the back chamber where the sun is. There's 26 theories for what they think that triple spiral is. Mine's the only one it even mentions why it's inside, and it's the only one that explains why it's inside, and it's exactly 1 degree of precession. You can measure this. It's a 60-foot long chamber from the entrance stone to the back chamber, and you can do the long trigonometry, long triangle, the trigonometry. It's 0.45 a meter from the. I measured it. I did the calculation in the back of the book. I put it in the appendix, and I said, "Please, you know, tell me what you think of it." It's the exact same thing for a precession of the Pleiades at Dos. And what you find is then that not only were they doing this, and this is the clever thing, this is the real punchline for me, is that they mixed cycles. So you see a lot of lunisolar calendars up in Donegal, where I live in Ireland. You find like a 13 rings, basically, a big giant. It's like a half a meter piece of rock art. It's got 13 concentric rings, 13 lunar months in the solar year. But then you have solstice lines like daggers going through these 13 concentric rings. So the solstices are obviously the sun, and then you have the 13 rings for the 13 lunar months. It's a beautiful concept to mix two calendars, because then you can see how calendars relate to each other, just like the Maya. And I know you want to reserve time for the Maya, so I'm going to bring them in. So, and I see a lot of...
We even get to the Maya, James, you're going to be headed back to Newgrange in 2017 with one of our previous guests, Brian Forrester, correct? You want to maybe give us some details on that for the audience?
Yeah, well, I'm going back. I've got a big tour in May, and I've got a big tour in September. So you can go to megalithicodyssey.com. You can catch the tours I do there, the symposium, the conference that I'm doing there. I'm doing a conference in May and a conference in September. Looking forward to Brian. Brian's coming over next September. Brian Forster, we're going to do Brittany in Ireland. Michael Tanger's doing England, Ireland, and Scotland. And I probably have Kerry Cassidy coming over as well for June with Maria Wheatley. I don't know. I have to confirm that. I don't know. I get a lot of interest in Ireland now, and I get a lot of interest in Maria's in England doing her thing. She's my co-author and co-presenter. A lot of time for Maria. And I guess what my aim is, just, you know, when I'm doing the megalithic documentary, I know that there's great things that I've discovered and great things and concepts, but it's not a book, and it's not a prolific piece of body of work, but it is insightful, and it's the best way to present that is in digital media. You know, with either documentaries or episodes and stuff like that, because I can put stuff together and make it work. And that's why I'm doing the documentary out of posterity, it's not the James Swagger show. I don't want it to be. I want it to be about megaliths, not about me. I don't even want to star in it. I'm not in it that much. I'm only in it when I need to be. And even at that, I'm a bit reluctant. So I'm producing and directing it. And I have a whole wealth of people in there. And I've got people, you know, looking at not just the acoustics and the astronomy. That's my thing. That's kind of what I led into. And I'm interested in that in a scientific sense.
You have another book on megalithic acoustic history as well, right?
I did. I had it on Kindle for about a year, and I pulled it. And I really pulled it because I had people stealing my work and copywriting it. It was my main issue. So I pulled it, and until I release the documentary next May, I'm going to release the 8 books. I have already got the megalithic acoustic mystery and the Newgrange Sirius mystery. But they're going to release 8 books simultaneously with the 8 episodes. So there will be a companion set. And Marie is going to do 2 books. I'm going to do my 2 books. And we're doing 4 books together. So it's going to be a fuller package. And I didn't want to pull it, but I had other research that came in too in Sardinia. So I pulled it. I'm really excited about that, because I'm going to do the origins and cosmology of the megalithic builders. I'm going to look into the acoustics. I'm going to look up the Neolithic mind, that these people were probably shamans, and the best way to think about them is like a proto-shamanic culture. We look at shamans today, and we go, our benchmark for what a shaman is something in Peru or Brazil, and that's fine. I mean, shamans are seers, like, but the whole idea of what shamanism is, or druidism, or whatever you want, it's everything morphs all the time. Even the English language morphs. In the next 20 years, they'll update the Oxford English Dictionary with the new words. So everything is human traits to morph. So I'm looking at that from consciousness, because I want to know about the people. People seem to forget about the people. It's like archaeology does with the stones and the bones, and that's it. They want to look at you know, what they can dig up and make a few, you know, objections about what they think and opinions, and then that's it. And it's like, well, you haven't explained who these people are. You haven't explained why they achieved what they did in the era that they did. And then I think, you know, that's why I'm looking. Maria's into like the bones and skulls and research. And I think, you know, if you can find the skulls of the people and the bones of these people, and they have really weird attributes, they may have been a different strain of us, or at least a very, very different race, like, at the very least, a very different race that either went down out of the record or we either amalgamated with our own gene pool. And I think that when you have these aspects, you've got to look at that too. So looking at the astronomy, looking at the acoustics, looking at the rituals and the practices, looking at alternative theories of how they move these monuments and stuff like that. So each episode in the documentary, Megalithic Odyssey Season 1, will be, you know, going for, like, the knowledge and what's on the eight aspects are that, you know, everybody wants to know where did these people come from and how did they do it. But there's also missing out some of the good stuff too. I have a major monumental task, Anyextee, because even within academia, they don't even attribute this as a standardized European Neolithic culture, megalithic culture, a Western European megalithic culture. The English don't talk to the Irish, the Spanish don't talk to the Portuguese, the Maltese don't talk to the Sardinians. Like, and there's so much connecting all of these things. I could spend like a whole documentary just connecting the dots. The same art, the same architecture, the same mindset, the same styles, the same monuments, the same alignments, the same conceptual ideas of astronomy. It's insanity to not link this stuff, and nobody's done it yet. And I'm doing this out of posterity, and I'm doing it because it's nobody else is doing it. And I understand that it's not everybody that would do it. I'm a systems analyst. I look at all the data. I zoom out and I look at the full system. I don't care if you're looking at ancient Egyptian, or if you're looking at astrology, or if you're looking at the human body or psychology. I don't care what the system is. The system's irrelevant to me. I want to see all the data you got. Don't keep the data from me. Give me everything you got. I look at all the data and I'll say, well, that data is affecting this data. And this is great because this kind of links together. And when you zoom out, you get a better perspective. It's not rocket science. All humans are all systems analysts. We have a system of survival. That's how we got here. We have a system of eating. We have a system of sleeping. We understand our own body system, our biological systems. We have our own way of social networking and systems like that. So, you know, we're all systems analysts, but we have it switched off because we're having to survive in a world that's not really made for human, you know, progression. And that's called the real world or Western world. Not that the Eastern world is too much better either, but they have a different philosophical thing on it. But it's this modern age. Okay, don't get me wrong. I don't want to go back to the Dark Ages either. I don't want to like my technology, but it's like it's not being recognized. You know, we've got to look at this thing. That ancient mysteries are there. You can understand them in different ways. Open your mind. You know, look at all the data. See how it relates, and use your cup on. Look at what's there. I mean, but people just, oh, we've been told something, and they switch it off, and, you know, unfortunately that goes on.
Megalithic Odyssey certainly sounds like an exciting project, James. And
it's an expensive one too,
I can imagine. I really have to appreciate your process, though, going into everything, you know, the whole interdisciplinary approach.
You know what I wanted, you know what I wanted to do? I wanted to go to a megalithic region and do something like do it to death, like go to England and then do a little thing, like a little episode there. It wasn't the way to do it. The way I did it was the most expensive way, the most difficult way, the most complex way, because I went to as many different various countries in Europe, different aspects, the ones that had the biggest pieces of the puzzle, Brittany, Portugal, Malta, Sardinia, Scotland. Unfortunately, that's very time consuming. I brought in people with me. I didn't just do it on my own. I had Laird Scranton. I flew him over from New York and I went to the Orkneys with him because he's got a major piece of the puzzle there, and I think it's very interesting and it's very hard to deny. And I a lot of respect for Laird because of the Dogon research.
Dogon cosmology, sure.
You know, and I never mentioned that either, but I did come across Teresa Fergani, a Portuguese researcher, at the same time as Laird, and we talked about it when I had Laird on my show. And it's kind of like I spoke to him because of the Dogon. I said, do you know Teresa Fergani? And he's like, yeah, you know. And I said, yeah, because I came across her paper online. And that's why I say the Capricorn radio show has always given me ways of meeting people that I sometimes talk up here. And I call people my friends now that I met on radio shows. And it's like I've synthesized the social network off air somehow. But Teresa Vergani wrote Ethnomathematics and of the Dogon, and showed you that the solar wheel, the spiral, and all the same art that you find at megalithic art. Because I don't see Dogon art, I see megalithic art. And I think, and Laird's looking at that too up in the Orkneys, I think that the Dogon can be traced back to Egypt, and some of the Egyptian concepts are prevalent in the art with the heliacal rising. We have the same art for the solar wheel in Loch Crew and Doth in the megalithic world, the spiral as well. Did they have the same teacher, or were the Egyptians Irish and the Irish? So, you know, think about it whatever way you want. They could also have had the same teacher. That's another way to look at it. You know, and that gets you out of, oh, ancient Egyptians were in Ireland, or personally, that's where Laird's going with the Orkneys thing, that they may have originated there. I'm open to any of that. To me, I don't care. I just want to look at the data and say, there's a commonality, explain it. And it's a commonality is not just a loose idea. It's extremely difficult to get away from. So I want to know why. I want to know why. There's commonalities with artifacts, physical artifacts. There's commonality with conceptual knowledge. So that's why I've looked at all of this thing, and I've brought the certain people in for the documentary to look at it all.
It's great that you're really, you know, taking the broad scope of across the board with everything. Why don't we zoom in on another region right now and bring in the acoustics? Because I know you recently, about a year or so ago, maybe less, you went to the Yucatan. There isn't a day that goes by that you won't find droves of tourists, or as our good friend John Anthony West would call them, grockles, piled up in front of the El Castillo pyramid. Could you tell us a bit about what goes on there, James?
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned El Castillo. Well, the Yucatan is riddled with all sorts of stuff. You know, there's 5,000 pyramids in the Maya world. I think Chichen Itza and the Yucatan, the whole complex there, you'd just waste a whole day in there. You wouldn't even appreciate or get all of it. Like, yeah, and there's mass tourism there now. I mean, the acoustics there and the astronomy there at that place is insane. I'm sure you hear the bird clapping and the chirping sound.
The fascinating part is the fact that the special echo produced is eerily similar to the sound produced by the Quetzal bird, which is a mystery in itself.
They worshipped. The question then you ask yourself is, did they worship the bird because of the sound they created at the pyramid?
That's right.
Or did they try to make the pyramid produce a sound to make the bird?
Yeah.
Either way, it's weird. It doesn't make sense. If you stand at the Great Ball Court there as well, I had my brother there with me. He was doing cameraman. I gave him a free trip, but he had to do cameraman and drive me. But we tested out the acoustics. If you stand at a certain location towards the end, you have standing waves set up and acoustic amplification. The archaeologists that actually excavated that, and they knew about that because the people that were excavating could hear their own voices very, very loudly and amplified from the other end. It doesn't make sense because it's open. It's like an open air auditorium, but you don't see it. You don't see how the acoustics work. You just don't know. Your brain can't process it. So you need to, like, you put an acoustic map in and see how that works. And then you have certain pyramids in the Maya world that have all sorts of acoustics. The question is, was it deliberate or not? When I wrote the Megalithic Acoustic Mystery, I studied acoustics all around the ancient world, and archaeoacoustics is a very fascinating, very, very fascinating subject. But I look at the pyramids in Egypt, and I looked at the acoustics there, and I think the acoustics was deliberate there. I look at the acoustics of the hypogeum of Malta, this underground megalithic stroke neolithic ossuary, and the acoustics there, for me, Anyextee, is just insanity. It's like it's infrasound that hits you in the chest when you armor chant into a little oracle hole, they call it. They give them all these names, by the way, the oracle hole and the holy of holies, all these rooms within the hypogeum. It's just a Christianity naming, a labeling of these places. But they put a little niche in the wall, and when you armor chant into it, it activates the whole acoustic chamber. And I know you're from a music background. You'll appreciate this. The hypogeum of Malta, basically the rooms that they carved down there were rooms within rooms within rooms, and it's a three-story, if not seven-story complex. We don't know because they won't let us go down any deeper, and it's been blocked off. Oh. But the rooms have an aperture like a sound hole on a guitar box, And that's why the whole thing resonates at the male vocal range, because they have carved an aperture like we have a sound hole in a guitar box to every room. There is no doorways. There's apertures. The same as the megalithic chambers of Ireland and Scotland. You have apertures going into the recesses. You step over these stupid floor sills that are just an obstacle to you. They're not any structural. They're just sitting there. There's no waterproofing. There's no physical structural reason for them being there. But they are creating the aperture. And you go an aperture into a recess. And that's what gives you an acoustic enhancement. I can show you great examples of that in Carroll Keel in the west of Ireland, where they have the recesses have their own corbelling up to the top, and then they have a little opening, the feedback loop of the acoustics back into the central chamber again, giving you an even more advanced hyperacoustic chamber. The question about the Maya world is that they did acoustics in a different way, or if they intentionally did it at all. But I look at what they did in the Maya world, and I looked at all other cultures, and everywhere you find these observational cosmologists, as I call them, the astronomy with the naked eye, you find acoustics knowledge. And I think, you know, was there an ancient culture that studied acoustics and astronomy? A master culture? I think the master culture, there were seafarers. I think there was a seafaring ancient global culture that went round everywhere. I think there's a lot of evidence for that. And I think that these guys set up pockets here, there, and everywhere. There was a civilization, a race that went around in ancient times. And, well, the Maya's like 11th century or whatever, and they fizzled out then or whatever. And, you know, these guys are going back to the Olmecs. The Olmecs right. went into the Aztecs, the Toltecs, the Mixtecs, the Huatecs. I lose count of who's who down there. It's like, so I just think the acoustics down in the Maya world is a bit more difficult to explain. There's better examples of it that are easily recognizable to explain. But don't make no mistake down there, the astronomy down there is extremely advanced. If you go to El Caracol, and I talk to people this all the time, the El Caracol Observatory is built on a base. I don't know if you know this, Anyextee, but most people don't know this. I don't know anybody else talking. I think this is one of the most amazing, fascinating things of the Maya cosmology. They built the El Caracol, they call it the snail because it's got this spiral staircase going up to this. It looks like a dome on the roof, but it actually was perfectly cylindrical. It's just eroded at the top. But there's three viewing windows at the top that are linked to Venus and the extreme setting points of Venus. And then you have the oblong base is aligned to the equinoxes. So the diagonal of the oblong base one way hits the equinox, and the diagonal of the other base hits the solstices. And as beautiful as that is, it's a hybrid monument, both tracking the solstices, i.e. Earth, and Venus at the top. The British archaeologists, when they went over in the excavations in the 20s, they found it so distasteful that they couldn't build a square base. They thought they were idiots. That's honestly what they thought of it. But they didn't realize the ingenuity of that monument. So here's the thing, right? If you if you've observed Venus, you'll see it as the morning star, then it 260 something days, and then it disappears for 50, and then it comes back as the evening star for 260 days, 63 or something like that, and then it disappears for 50 days again. And the whole thing is about 584 days, I think, is for the Venus. But the problem is we're on Earth, and our solar trajectory is 365 days. So the ratio is 365 to 584, but it takes 8 years for that to happen because of the two orbits going around the sun. So the nearest whole number is 8 years that will perfectly repeat, 2,920 days, because the ratio is 5 to 8. So you will have 5 times 583 plus 8 times 365 for the year, solar year. So it's solar at the bottom and Venus at the top. And you must then give the Maya world, they didn't do ratios, they didn't do decimal fractions, decimal points like we do it. They did fractions and ratios. So they did a ratio of 365 to 584. Well, that's not an even number, is it? That's a bit harder to work out. So if you multiply the left side by 8 and you multiply the right side by 5, you get the same number. That gives you the best, that gives you the nearest whole number where the cycle repeats, 8 years. And they knew that. And they must have known that because he wrote it down. They have 2,920 days. you must at least give them that they knew that Venus, whatever they called Venus, whatever their name for Venus was, whatever their name for Earth was, that they knew that they were standing on a platform called Earth with solstices and equinoxes, and they were going around this object, the sun, and they knew that the ratio of Venus and Earth going around the sun repeated every 8 years, or they knew that it was a 5-to-8 ratio, which is Fibonacci, by the way. So they knew that. They knew that. And you must give them a cosmology of the solar system. They had at least Venus and Earth going around the sun, and it's written in stone, it's encoded in all of that monument, El Caracol. I think it's one of the most amazing monuments of the Maya world. Nobody talks about it.
I've had the opportunity to explore a lot of the Yucatan. In fact, my wife and I were recently married there at Uxmal. And while
I've seen the photographs of you at Uxmal. Uxmal, for me, was one of the most mind-blowing places. In terms of the art. When you see the Temple of the Nunnery and the serpents coming and twisting around each other and then disappearing into the wall and coming back out somewhere else. Amazing.
Can you tell us a bit about your experience at some of the other less popular sites and how they had an effect on you in the Yucatan?
Yeah, so I did actually go off the grid. I think Mayapan I found interesting because Mayapan, I found like a little microcosm of Chichen Itza. If you look at Mayapan, it's just a little miniature version of Chichen Itza. I thought that was incredibly interesting. Zibalchaltun, I don't know if you made it to Zibalchaltun any extent.
I haven't yet. That's actually one. It's up in the
northern Yucatan. Yeah. It's right up near the north.
It's northwest, right?
Yeah, northwest Yucatan, yeah. I wasn't going to go there. I was on the Yucatan Highway and I was hitting site after site every day. I had my brother driving. I said, keep driving, next 100 miles, next 50 miles. I just kept going and hitting as many places as I could in a day. And I was there for, I don't know, 21 to 18 days, something like that. I hit as many places as I could. And I just, you know, snapped and took as much video and photography as I could. And I was looking for, like you just said, the pieces off the beaten track. I didn't know what I was looking for because I knew all about the big places, the famous places, sure. The temple of the magician Uxmal and Chichen Itza and Coba and Tulum.
There's I hit so all those much more out there.
I know. And that's just within the northern Yucatan, you can go crazy. So I comes across Zibalchaltun. It is a real gem. I mean, so you're looking at this pyramid that had another pyramid on top of it. The Toltecs came in and conquered the Maya. And then they put their own pyramid on top of the other pyramid. We know that because you can still see a window in time. The archaeology came in and just stripped away the outer pyramid, looking quarry in it. And then they realized there was another pyramid inside it. So they left the right-hand side of the pyramid, still the older pyramid. You can see where the older pyramid was on top of the other pyramid. You can look at it snapshot as they froze with the archaeology. And here's the thing. The pyramid inside was so, so advanced geometrically. I mean, if you stand and look at it at a 45-degree angle, a face comes out. And if you stand and look at it face on, you don't see the face. And it's like two eyes, a mouth, and a nose. And if you look at all the smaller temples, they're so numerous like that. If you look at the coving and look up high, you stand and look at it sideways. You look at a 45-degree angle, you'll see faces and imagery coming out. And but you stand and look at a face on perpendicular, you don't see anything. Mm. And they turn a two-dimensional wall into a three-dimensional shapes by doing that. And they had to be projecting this image in their head conceptually before they even put a stone in place. I find that amazing that they could even conceive that. And with Zibalchaltun as well, so the sun would come down on the equinox and freeze inside the window. So as you look down that whole causeway and you see Zibalchaltun pyramid at the end, you will see the sun in the window. It's there every equinox. And then you have the angle of the pyramid, depending what angle you look at it. These guys were projecting geometries into their consciousness. And personally, I think when you look at it, it screams that they were doing entheogens. And ayahuasca type stuff or mushroom, I don't even know. There were some sort of entheogens involved in their shamanism. Neither good nor bad. I just think that they saw geometries on those visionary states, and I just think they projected their consciousness and their geometry and their philosophy and their cycles. I just think they were projecting what was in their heads into physical 3D form.
How would you compare some of the sites that you've seen? You've been to Egypt, for example. How would you compare that in terms of what you experienced in the Yucatan?
Egypt, again, is a whole Egypt's a whole different ball game. So you have the masonry there seems to be so much more advanced. I mean, you look at the stuff in the Maya world. Again, it's more conceptual stuff going on because the stone was mostly rubble fill and not large heavy blocks. But it's like they all had the same concept originally, but then some guys had extra master mason skills, if that's the way to put it. But the stuff in Egypt, I mean, I've seen places in Egypt. I went out with Patricia and Yusuf Awiyan out there, and I got to see places that mostly people won't even see on the normal Egypt tours. And there was a giant, what I call a crystal altar. It looked like it had four compass points. And this thing is like 12-foot piece of like crystal, 12-foot wide by 12-foot wide square, and with compass arrow points on it facing north, south, east, and west exactly, with a circular crystal altar in the middle of it. I'm like, oh, well, this is like, you can see where core marks went down. You can see it, like, you know, you can't do it with a chisel. You can't do it with, you know, you couldn't chisel it because the matrix of the crystal would crack and fracture. You'd have to wear it down or machine it down. How advanced that was, I don't think they had to have power tools or not. I think you can still core and drill with like a mechanical process. So, you know, I don't need to go crazy and say like there was ancient machines like. But I do see a machining process there, and I've seen that. I think the blocks that they put in place are just so sophisticated. I mean, if you go to the bent pyramid of Sneferu, I think it is, the casing blocks are still in place there. And the fact that they built that pyramid and changed the angle of it on the way up, that is incredibly mind-blowing. Incredibly that they changed the pitch of the pyramid. To do it with just one straight edge, I find insane. You know, to do it with and bending the pyramid and changing the angle, that's a logistic nightmare right there at Anyextee. The fact of moving the large heavy stones, I think, you know, you can go to many heavy stones on the planet, like heavy tutage, Baalbek, and you go to Peru and you can see Ollantaytambo there with the red granite wall, which came from the other mountain, by the way. Always fascinates me where they take this quarried stuff and they don't build a monument near the quarry, they quarry the stuff and ship it large miles on. Sacsayhuaman, like I mentioned, but if you go to Egypt and to the Sphinx Valley Temple, you will find there's a lintel stone there, and we can get 200 ton, it's a 200 ton lintel stone, we can get 200 ton up and down off the ground by putting several cranes around it, no problem, we can do that. But what we can't do is do it where it is in the Sphinx Valley Temple, because it's in a very tight corner. And you can't get it into the tight corner because the crane's going to be in the way. So how do they put that stuff in the corner? So I just find stuff like that. And so I always find these little gems that are really indicative of something incredibly advanced. And I will give that advancement to their mindset. And I'll say, look, it doesn't matter how advanced you are in the left brain world, because we're as pretty advanced as we kind of get. It doesn't matter how much more advanced do we have to get to put like something out of place, because we can't do it now. We could probably do the Great Pyramid now, but we couldn't do it in the time frame that they're giving them. You know, if you gave the most biggest engineering construction firm on the planet right now a limitless bank account, all the labor they needed, and say replicate the Great Pyramid, it's going to be difficult. I don't think they would say yes. And if they could do it, I don't think they would get it to the same standard. I don't think they'd get it to the standard. I just don't know how they did it. But then, if we can't do it in the left brain world, then it tells you that we, did, you know, they didn't do it in the left brain world. And that's why I say I don't think it was the opposite either, right brain one. I think it was a perfectly balanced hemisphere. We know that when the left and the right is bridged and perfectly, that the sum of the two parts together is better than each one totaled and combined. So that corpus callosum is firing in all cylinders, synapses are all firing. They think about things, solutions in different ways. The more creative you are, the better you are with logistics and solutions. You know, it's just the way processes are.
Well, I'm certainly very excited about Megalithic Odyssey. We're running short on time. I want to get out. When can we expect Megalithic Odyssey to drop? When's it going to be available, do you think, James?
Yeah, okay. I've set the date. You know, I got delayed on it. And the reason I got delayed was because I was meeting great researchers, Anyextee. I was just meeting.
You can go on forever.
Yeah, it's like I had a cap at some point, and I already pushed back the date. So the date is, and it is going to be released on May 14th at the same time as the conference, Megalithic Odyssey Symposium. I'm predominantly putting on this symposium for people who are contributors or Not all the time, but anybody's in the documentary is getting a little speak at the Megalithic Odyssey Symposium. I did one last year and doing another two next year. And so everybody that's pretty much been in the documentary is having a little speak at the conference. Some people, like, I've got John Anthony West in. He's coming in from New York next time. So that's my pinnacle. I'm putting 8 books out for release date May 14th. The Kindles will definitely be ready by then. And the 8 episodes will be out by May 14th. They're going to have a free pilot episode for everybody to watch as well, so that I give something out for free as well. And then the symposium as well is going to be a conference surrounding that as well. So all roads head to May 14th. So megalithicodyssey.com as well.
It has been an honor and a privilege. I want to thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedule. Clearly,
you're
not sleeping over there. I don't know how you're doing it all. But to
share, I'm going to Malta tomorrow, dude. I'm off to Malta. I got a place in Malta as well, and I'm doing a bit more because I got a new 4K camera. I can't wait to get on the road with and do some stuff. It cost me an arm and a leg, but it's like I'm going to go into season 2 already with a 4K camera. So I'm going to raise the bar for myself even again. So, but I'm looking forward to it. And anytime, brother, look, you give me a call anytime. I enjoyed it today. I really did.
Well, thank you so much for sharing all these fascinating insights with our audience. And even myself, I mean, I've got so many loose ends I got to chase up now. I mean, mind blown. This has been a very informative episode, to say the least. I'm sure our audience is going to appreciate this. And I hope to see you in Ireland one day and perhaps even in the Yucatan.
Perhaps in the Yucatan as well. Who knows? We've got definitely the similar interests. So I'm sure we're going to meet somewhere, brother.
Mr. James Swagger, ladies and gentlemen. And James, one more time, you want to let everybody know where they can find your books, everything you're working on?
JamesSwagger.com for me is an author, though I don't update it that regularly. It's just a public information site. Megalithic Odyssey for everything I'm doing with the books, the DVDs, the conferences, the tours, megalithicodyssey.com. That's the main one. If you like my podcast, CapricornRadio.com, I've got some live shows there. But other, it's like a little mini network now. And then Capricorn members, if you want the archive and stuff like that. And then, of course, just get on YouTube. Just type in Capricorn Radio into YouTube. There's a whole army. I've got Disclosed Truth TV on YouTube with 126,000 subscribers. I've got Disclosure Nation with about 38,000 subscribers. And then the Capricorn, I don't know, it's like I never could have dreamed of the success of that. So it's pretty much everything I do is on YouTube anyway. And I try to keep as much as I do open anyway. So you can do it all there.
James Swagger, everybody, and we're out.
This episode is brought to you by AncientEgyptMysterySchools.com. Immerse yourself in the hidden teachings of the ancient mystery traditions. For thousands of years, initiates have examined the meanings of sacred texts said to hold the secret path towards ascension. But how can we decipher these often enigmatic phrases and symbols? Join the line of ascended masters on a quest for deeper truths of our universe. Follow along as we trace the powerful evolution of humankind's most illuminating secrets. Begin to embark on your journey today and discover your divine rite of passage at AncientEgyptMysterySchools.com.